And good evening. Welcome to Informed Sources on News Channel 3, where we discuss the week's big stories with local voices. I'm your host tonight, Mary Beth Conley. We appreciate you joining us. In just a moment, I'll introduce our panel of guests. But this week, our top story. Next Monday marks 1 year since protesters in downtown Memphis shut down the Hernando de Soto Bridge, shutting down the interstate over the Mississippi. Officer-involved shootings of Philando Castile in Minnesota and Alton Sterling in Louisiana sparked last year's protest. Close to 1,000 protesters shut down traffic on the bridge for about 4 hours, but the protest ended peacefully when then interim police director Mike Rawlings took off his bulletproof vest and walked up the bridge to talk with protest leaders.
One of the things that I expressed to the protesters on the bridge is like, look, what are your goals? Tell me what you expect to accomplish in the next hour on this bridge. And I said, we're going to get off this bridge. So I'd rather people come to the table and have a civil conversation.
If he's interested in building that trust and maintaining that trust between the community and law enforcement, then he will be transparent and he will be open enough to invite, just like the city of Baton Rouge, he'll be open and transparent enough to invite the Department of Justice to come in and do a thorough investigation of Memphis Police Department.
Now, in the days following the protest, activists demanded a number of things of city leaders. Number one, the immediate promotion of Mike Rawlings as police director, plus increased sensitivity training for officers, increased minority participation in public works projects, and more funding for youth empowerment programs. And for his part, Director Rawlings asked the protesters to do their part to stop the violence in Memphis and find peaceful ways to resolve conflicts. So, what changes did the protests bring about? On the show tonight, Otis Sanford, WREG's political commentator and holds the Hardin Chair of Excellence for Journalism at the University of Memphis. Jackson Baker, a frequent panelist on Informed Sources, is a columnist with the Memphis Flyer. Devontae Hill is a minister and activist who helped organize that Memphis protest. And Ken Moody, a special assistant to the mayor of the city of Memphis. Good to have you, as
Thank
always.
Thank you for the invitation.
So, on the issue of Mike Rawlings becoming police director, that happened actually within days of the protest. We can check that one off. Let's start with you, Mr. Hill. The other items, what grade would you give the city in terms of how well this last year has done?
We start off rather hot already, huh? No. In all honesty, as it relates to creating programs for youth initiatives, developing those type of programs, I'd probably give the city, in the past couple of days, definitely a B. I say a B, and the reason why I'd say a B because the My Brother's Keeper initiative was as solid as it gets. If we can maintain that momentum, the pools being open, we working with the libraries. When we keep that momentum going, we can accomplish amazing things. In the latter part of the school semester, a lot of times you can do, you know, okay during the school semester, but when it comes to midterms and making up work, that's when you really got to pull it together. And I feel like here the past at least 2 months, the city has been doing, you know, a strong part in trying to pull things together for the most part.
All right.
Give credit where credit is due, you know?
Ken, I want to go to you because it seems that Mayor Strickland, in an interview the other day, was almost trying to downplay the significant impact of the march by saying that the things that the group was asking for was already done or was already in the works. It sort of came across as sort of downplaying the significance of it. How do you see that? And what was the mayor really trying to say?
He wasn't downplaying. He was saying exactly what you said, Otis, that we had already begun doing those things that they asked for after the protest. And so it wasn't a matter of the mayor downplaying. We don't hold press conferences when we're doing our day-to-day responsibilities. Again, we had already started improving youth programs. We had already increased minority participation. There was a process in place to hire the police director, Mike Rawlings, you know. So we had already started doing those things. We hadn't made those things known to the public, but I mean, that's what the mayor meant. He wasn't downplaying what they had done. He was just saying, hey, we'd already started doing those things.
In all honesty, if I can interject, when a parent doesn't tell a child, I love you, and the child doesn't feel loved, the parent can feel love, feel like they're giving that love all day, but until they tell the child, I love you, show the child I love you, they don't love the child. And so, you know, with all due respect, as it relates to the mayor, I think that comment, for a lot of us, it stunned us, because I think for the minority community, the bridge was, it was momentous in at least bringing us together and creating a unity between the two of us. So maybe he didn't mean it in the manner that he meant it in, but it was definitely interpreted, you know, as in the bridge was a nonchalant event that really didn't have to happen. It shouldn't have happened. I think the bridge protest, it had to happen. It needed to happen. The reason why it had to happen, it needed to happen, because nobody went to jail. Nobody got hurt. And so it was a God moment, is what we've been calling it. It was a moment that needed to happen for the community.
It may have had to happen for them, but again, it didn't need to happen for us to get started doing what we needed to be doing. And that's what the mayor was saying. I mean, it happened for them, and they needed that to happen, but we were already working on those issues.
Did it increase urgency, though? Sometimes you have to have a deadline, you have to have some noise. I mean,
not at all, because if you remember when the mayor ran, he knew then that we needed to do better for y'all youth. He knew then that we were at a dismal percentage without minority participation, and so we already knew the sense of urgency. I'm a lifelong Memphian, been here all my life, and so we understand and understood the sense of urgency. And so, I mean, not to downplay what happened with the bridge mark, but we had already understood what needed to be done, and we had begun to address those.
You know, Jackson, I have to comment on that, because I'm reviewing Ken's activity a little bit. You were making those same points a year ago. At the time, you talked about programs that were already in effect. And I do think that you and the mayor have given names to some programs that are kind of unusual, and the very fact that they are there and they're progressive and you're pushing them. The Manhood University.
I love it.
That is the most magnificently named
that?
Program.
He said he loves
yeah.
Them.
Yeah. Yeah.
Listen, I give credit where credit is due. I'm not that critical of the mayor.
I think a B is a where you have.
Oh, that's pretty good.
Manhood University. I met with Ken. I said, man, I love that. Whatever I can do to help, I want to be a part of it. Anything that's progressing and moving the ball, you know, I can't help what the mayor says. I can't help how people interpret it. But what I can help is when you guys have got an initiative going that's going to serve the disenfranchised individuals in our community, yeah, I want my hand all over there without a doubt. I want to help.
But Jackson, I want to get to the context of the march. You've been around here a long time, grew up in this community as well, and have seen a lot of things that happen in this community. Mm-hmm. So to get to Mr. Hill's comment about this being a momentous event, how do you put it in this context? I don't think it necessarily rises to some of the events that happened, say the student marches and the student sit-ins in 1960 at the lunch counters and the library. It certainly doesn't rank with the sanitation strike marches, but it still was a momentous, as you say. How do you put it into context?
Well, I put it in the context of a national situation. Now you omitted the Elton Hayes situation at another huge event in which a young man was killed by police.
Was killed by police, yeah. And sheriff department.
Yeah. And that sort of thing has never stopped happening in the intervening year, not nationally. And there is a habit of mind that is more than local. I think that what we're talking about here is there are conspicuous efforts locally to do something about it. But in the context of the nation, this is going to be a festering sore for a long time. Yeah. Locally, maybe every 5 or 10 years, there's an incident that galvanizes the sentiment on this score.